rented a Linux for a while. I worked at Walter. So, at the moment, direct decoding, which promotes like for your TVs, conditioning units, that sort of thing. There's a few decoders in the kernel. There's also some use based decoders, but they're not very great. Latency is not good. Also, decoding is a pretty simple state machine, so it's perfect for a BPF program. And some time ago, I added a Lyric Mode 2 BPF program type. Using that, you can write infrared decoders in BPF. So I wrote the patches for the kernel, and I thought, while those patches are coming for review, I'll write user space. Those patches were sent in 2019, and it's taken me another 5 years to actually do the work, because this is something I do in my spare time. So, I've written this new tool called SIR. That's consumer infrared. So it's definitely confused with AIDA. It's got a number of keymap formats. And it's kind of designed to replace all the infrared tooling for Linux. With one better tool that does pretty much everything. And I decided to write in Rust, which has been great. So there's this language called IRP, IRP notation, and in IRP notation you can describe any infrared protocol. There's databases available of all the different protocols that exist, several hundred. So by supporting IRP, exactly, we can support any remote protocol that exists. So when I started working on this, I realized that it kind of looked like a regular expression. So I started to approach it like a regular expression and generate state machines. So in a little bit, the next slide works. I hope this is a little bit readable. So the CK is the carrier. The code does not actually import. 600 is the unit. That's the number of microseconds that it's going to take. The square bracket is how you encode bits. So what's left of the type symbol, or minus one, is a positive number is the flash. So that means red light is on. A negative number is off. So there's a gap. So a zero bit encoded as 600 microseconds. Infrared light, by 600 microseconds of no light, and then a one is encoded by 200 microseconds of light, followed by 600 microseconds of gap. If I encode a bit, then that's followed by the actual data stream. That's the four, so that's 4 times 600 is 400 microseconds of flash, followed by 200 microseconds of gap. Colon 8 is how you encode a variable f bits, and then followed by 45 microseconds, milliseconds of gap, and then the f specifies the range of the variable. So underneath this thing you need to generate from that, which is kind of hard to read. The idea here is that a finite state machine, but now we actually add a few bits of information. So actually decode bits, we add them to the F variable. In more complex protocols, there are checksums, and then we can do things like checksums. You can take an existing variable and then it might be a variable which is inverted. You have an F, and then you have an inverted F, and then you can check it. There are various bits of key down, key repeat, key up. So this does get a bit more complicated. This is the basic form, really. As you can see, the command line you can use to generate the finally save NFA, and then the state machine gets saved as a dot file. Directly generated. This is the dot file directly in the slide. milliseconds of 1.600 milliseconds of gap. What has 600 milliseconds of flash followed by 100 milliseconds of gap? Because node, there's two edges on the millisecond, which means when you generate the BPF code, now you have to, a state machine which can be in multiple states at the same time. To generate, because in BPF code you have to maintain multiple possible states, which you don't want. And because it's a state machine, you can use the textbook answer to that, and that's converted to a DFA. To DFA conversion is just called the power set or subset conversion. In a performance slide, I'll show you what it looks like after conversion. It also removes empty nodes, so that the state machine is already a lot more simplified. The other way to simplify it, here we have a bit of encoding where light followed by a gap, or the other way around. It's a gap followed by a flash, by a light. So, if you follow the state machine, if a 1 byte is followed by a 0 byte, you have flash followed by flash. You get node J all the way around, and you end up node G by D. You have two flashes up to each other. You can merge those two spots. In the same way, you can have flash spots followed by flash if you have a 0 followed by a 1. By merging those paths, you again simplify the state machine. The simplified state machine. To read, okay. To make this easier, after merging the paths, you follow all the nodes and you pick up all the bits of code you come across. So, the merged edges, so the platform, for example, has all the code that comes across in those longer paths which have been merged. It looks like there's more code here now, but all the edges are much simpler because every edge has either a flash or a gap edge, and then it's followed by a gap, so it's inverted. There's never a flash followed by another flash, and that makes the decoder much simpler to write. Now, just one last improvement we can do. Your DFA, you may have multiple, you may have duplicate scripts. So you have the same nodes that occur in different parts of the state machine. You have the textbook answer, the NFA, DFA minimization. Reconstruct the DFA, and then you remove duplicate nodes. What end of that is that there's a protocol called Parsley 5, and this process of generating the state machine and going through various optimizations, we actually have a simpler state machine than the hand coded one that's in the criminal today. So, it's all been worthwhile. So, we have a state machine, now we want a BPF program. As I learned today, I can probably use global variables rather than using a hash map for. An array for the variables. But you walk the state machine, look for all the variables, get an array for those, use another variable for know which node you're in, which state. And then you generate the LVM IR. So you load the state variable, your node number, do a big switch on that, and then for each state, you go through all the edges. Of each state, you generate the code for that, and then if you don't match one of the edges, edges, you move to the next edge, try that. If no edges match, you have a decoding error and you just reset the whole decoder. So that's kind of all that's to the code generation. So then once you've done that, you put the LVM IR, you can quickly generate the BPF code. We've optimized the state machine. Each edge has some code associated with it. There's some duplication there, but LVM helps you with that. So you actually end up with a pretty nice and short BPF code. You can just run this on the command line. Everything's done in memory. It's a binary. Using finite automation, you can write some pretty neat optimizations for machines. And then using LLVM to optimize it, very nice code generation. In Rust was actually a great choice. Working with state machines and comparing edges, etc., works very nicely in Rust. A similar mechanism could be reused for net filter programs, which I haven't looked at in detail, but that might be my next challenge. I don't know if anyone's working on something like this there. So, any questions?
Those BPF programs that you generate, do they upload it from user space? Like, they have some sort of like custom dynamically generated ones, or it's something that you would want to ship with the kernel?
So I have a use case program that generates these, and then you set my IRP. In user space, it compiles it to a BPF program and presses RAS to use AIA to actually load it as a program. Does that make sense?
Yeah, my question is more like, is there some set of those IDRs that like kernel has to handle kind of like as a standard feature, and like then you would need to provide those BPF programs from inside the kernel, or it's
this special BPF program called BPF proc lib to mode 2. It's a special program type, and these programs generate those program types.
Okay. And they're meant to be like loaded from users.
Yes.
Like that. Okay.
Yes. Yeah, so you provide you provide a key map, and then it loads the key map, and then it creates a program and loads it. It's actually a rather awkward name, BPF proc type lurk underscore mode 2. And then what you do is, if you have an infrared device, that's a lurk 0 or 1, etc. That's a card def. You open that, and then you put a special attach card to attach those particular devices. Okay. Maybe I should explain that actually. Yeah, so there is some. There are like program types. There are BPF infrared decoders right now, but they're all written in C.
I'm asking because I know that there is this type of program, but I've never seen anyone using it. So I was like, always wondering what is that.
All right. So there's existing a new program. But there's a program called IRT table, and that loads those like the program type.
You're saying like everything was written in Rust, so I'm assuming this NFA parsing, NFA DFA conversion is all in Rust?
Yes, that's right, yes.
And then you generate all the MIR from Rust as well?
Yeah, yes, equal.
And just from the LVM side, I know there is a speed API, but you find a library to generate all the MIR from Rust?
Yeah, it's just a thing called Inkwell.
What was it called again?
Inkwell. That gives you nice Rust bindings for LLVM. It's quite helpful. If you generate another valid LLVM IR, you usually get a Rust build error rather than a what you might otherwise get is like a call dump in the middle of LLVM.
And once the LLVM consumes the IR, it produces instructions. So what's the next step? Like, how do you load everything?
So the
like relocations and audio just generates a file for you.
Yes, so LLVM gives me an object file. And then there's AYA, which is great. It's like the Rust version of a libbpf. It passes the L file, so it just loads the map, and loads the programs. All that is I didn't have to write all of that. I just wrote some patches to make it support decoders. It gives you it's boring to look at, but if you look at the actual output of the decoders with the BPF V3 2-bit comparison. Additional jumps with immediate comparison. That's very useful for this. The output is really neat and really short. Yeah, my laptop. Linux Media Summit earlier, and we were talking about how we're going to replace the existing tooling with this. Well, I want to ask you if any more things. The scheme would be useful for netfilter type programs.
There's the what's called BPF filter developers somewhere around.
Yeah.
You might want to talk with Quentin. Yeah.
All right.
Maybe try to catch him tomorrow or something.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
If you're gonna be around.
From what I know from looking at the patches, kind of programs they have the outputs using helper functions, but what does the input look like? So, what does this IR signal that you're processing look like from a program context?
Yeah, the program context is actually just a U32 with the length, how long infrared light's been on or off, the microsecond. It's a bit like Morse code, it's just sort of longer and shorter, sort of on and off.